Strong language from the start now on four, as our journey through the musical underground stops at the sound of the suburbs.
I kind of think something's over by the time you've read about it. When something's just happening, and it's happening so fast, you don't have time to sit and think, you know what I mean? It's just like, it's happening and we're doing it. To me, that's the spirit of hardcore.
I can remember listening to Extreme Noise Terror and bands like that in my room, and I remember my mum knocking on the door going, are you actually killing someone in there?
All the punk rockers chased all the skinheads with machetes and bottles being thrown, and there was a lot of blood.
He doesn't have a penis anymore.
No.
When you said to the bass player, what do you want the bass to sound like? The bass player turns around and goes, well, what it sounds like when buildings are falling down continuously. So it just goes like...
The music was so hard to acquire, and I think in some ways that's a good thing, because what you got, you really absorbed and appreciated. If I sent off a 90-minute tape and someone filled it up for me with demos and 7-inches, I knew that tape inside out because I had played it to death, even if it was crap.
It was a bleak period. I mean, you know, when I think back, my enduring memories of the time are like of Margaret Thatcher and, you know, the miners' strike, the threat of nuclear war, which seems difficult for people to comprehend now. But, you know, we were actually living in fear of, like, the four-minute warning. Unemployment was rife. And, you know, there were very few prospects for people, you know, sort of UK 82. That just fueled the sort of intensity and angst of music, you know, especially that sort of second and third wave of punk rock. And if you turn the clock right back, you know, to even the Sex Pistols and the Clash, they took their influence from bands before them, the Stooges and MC5 and stuff like that. And then the second wave of punk bands took their influence from the first wave of punk bands. So suddenly everything starts to get distilled. And then the third wave of hardcore bands, you know, again, suddenly instead of, you know, being influenced by all these people like Eddie and Hot Rods and stuff, you've got bands that are purely being influenced by bands like Crass and Discharge and Disorder and Chaos UK. So everything's even more, you know, distilled and boiled back to basics, really.
UK hardcore then became something else. There's different ways that you can come at UK hardcore, where it coming out of UK punk thing. We were coming from a different place. We had different influences.
It got faster, noisier, heavier, more abrasive, more intense.
So you had Napalm Death, who were obviously more perhaps influenced at the Discharge end of things, and then you had the Stupids, who were definitely more influenced from the American hardcore side of things. So you had the two sort of pushing together and making this thing called hardcore at that time. You know, that was always the hardest thing for me, is like, if I speak to a layman, everyone's going to expect that it's the whole sort of UK 82 studs and bristles and, you know, mohawks, and that was not what it was about, really.
Made a good hardcore band was the drummer. It didn't have to be necessarily a good drummer, but just the kind of style, and it was quite distinct by slamming away with a slightly open hi-hat. So instead of, you know, you had more like, and then of course you'd speed it up, so it was... For me, it was just punctuating the stuff on the cymbals and, yeah, just going mental, basically. Yeah!
like a lot of kids, I was kind of getting into this kind of music mid-80s. And, you know, those days you couldn't just hear those bands easily. You had to, you know, you had to really hunt it out. Yeah, you'd read thanks lists on album sleeves, T-shirts other bands were wearing. So you'd buy Maximum Rock and Roll and you know, you got all the records listed in there. I would just basically go through fanzines and I would literally just spend hours just writing letters to everyone to trade tapes, to hear demos, sending off forever fanzines, just slowly digging deeper and deeper until you sort of get into the really good stuff.
There was such a big underground network of fanzines and tape trading. Tape trading was huge back then. You know, we were all doing mixtapes for each other.
I mean, when I think about it now and how difficult it looks in the digital age with how easy everything is now, you think, well, how did it work? You know, it must have taken such a colossal amount of work.
Yeah, this is a tape trading list. You can just see all the different, like, rehearsal tapes and live tapes. You've got the times here for each bit of recording, so you would work out enough to fill a 90-minute tape. So I would say, OK, well, I want the extreme noise, that's 20 minutes, and then you sort of pick all the different bits to fill up a 90-minute tape, and he'd do the same from your tape. So you've got the time, the grading of the quality. Shit, good. Brilliant.
You would seriously end up with, like, heavily degraded, sped up. I mean, I remember some demos thinking, this is amazing, fucking so fast, and like, it's really distorted, it's amazing. And then you finally get the record, it's very different, much slower, much cleaner sound. And you'd quite often be disappointed. And that was literally because people were taping and resending these cassettes out. Quite often people would write on the outside of envelopes. Sometimes you get massive drawings and whatever, but I remember quite often there'd be like soap stamps.
Say if I sent a letter to somebody, I'd put soap on the stamp, and then you get to the other side and the guy would go, rub it off, and then put soap on the stamp and use it again. The stamps used to go back and forth to America and all that. They'd send my stamps back, I'd send them back to them, and that's how you'd save money as well. Like,
you do your hair with soap as well, so you'd have spiky hair with soap, and then you know, do your hair, do the stamp as well.
A bit like that, right? And you dunk into the water and you go slobber-dobber-dobber, and then you go bing, 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 and you pull them up.
I miss that. That whole network was fantastic and very fundamental to the worldwide hardcore scene, in that you had to sort of give something, you had to put pen to paper, you had to think.
The whole thing with this whole scene was it was little pockets going on everywhere. It wasn't just all about London. In fact, it was probably not about London, in a way.
When I was at school, Sangs would cover all these new bands like Discharge, say Exploited.
John Peel was massive. You know, I used to listen to John Peel every night, without fail.
And he played the early Discord records and then Touch and Go records. He had those and he was playing those, so you'd hear those.
So you heard them? You
know? Not that you could actually get them, but you'd heard them. For me, once I heard those US bands, that really UK bands, I just really drifted away from that because they just weren't fast enough. When we started trying to get going, no one's into it. People just hated us. Just hated us. We played a couple of places, like little village halls. We've rented ourselves and got our own PA. I just got a band from school, indie band, and us. Yeah, and obviously, people were just like,
they were just staring at us.
Just like they hated
us. Like we'd just landed from Mars or something. Well, there were punks there who were walking out, shaking their heads. You know, there was this one guy who was going, they're like Discharge, but they're too fast.
So we knew we had to get out of the area, well, particularly out of the Western area, because we wouldn't have ever played, and no one would have come anyway.
Good God, we've been invaded by pirates. It has. That's the Matthew.
It is tiny. Man, if they went all across the Atlantic in that, fair play to them.
The first wave really conformed to the traditional music business model. Because so many of those first bands got signed to major label, all the bands that kind of formed in their wake, there was a chance that they could get signed to a major as well. So that was almost a kind of goal, you know. As the 80s went on, that didn't become a goal anymore. As the mainstream lost interest in punk, it just created its own little world. There was never any aspiration to be in the mainstream at all for those bands. That was never the goal.
There was so much competition to have the massive urgency and power and rah to it all. And I found that really an attractive thing to try and capture.
Yeah. Well, my name's Mark Harwood. I'm the proprietor of Spring Bell Studios. But this is the sort of rehearsal room area in which an enormous amount of local music has been put together all the way through from, you know, the Stupids and the early days of all the kind of mad Space Maggots bands that they put together. And there was Extreme Noise Terror. Through here, there's this old tape machine which I run the signal through. That was made in 1966 when we won the World Cup, you know, and we were somebody. But then this is fun because this came off a submarine. My family are a bit Navy, so a few things have drifted into my possession, you know. So that actually is off a warship. With ENT, we'd done all kinds of things, like even just miking up an old Marshall guitar amplifier, and you just turned all the knobs full clockwise until it was making the most horrendous amount of noise. And we got, like, the smallest amount of guitar that you could possibly get coming through the signal of... And so it was like a sort of a distant bell chime on a really stormy night. And if you didn't have a load of old-fashioned sort of rubbish, you know, to stick it through, you wouldn't have been able to get all of that atmosphere and sound, you know. It had all been terribly clean and nice and polite and totally not what I wanted at all. It had to sound like it was about to break. So I just think that if you can record things that are ultra on the edge and capture that energy, that's what the job of the recording studio is. Who cares what the noise is? It's all noise, you know, it's called extreme noise.
Well, we're off to see Extreme Noise Terror in Ipswich at the Caribbean Centre, where they have quite a few thrash gigs, hardcore gigs, whatever you want to call them. I mean, they're not very elegantly turned out, so, but there's never any sense of impending danger, even if you're rather, you know, so there aren't that many 50-year-old blokes there with their wives and sons.
That Suffolk Comforts clip is brilliant. I mean, I remember that airing at the time, so it must be about 1989. One, it was fantastic to see Extreme Noise Terror on the television, and John Peel just so eloquently summed up the whole thing. And I think the nature of his interest in music, he was always looking for extremes, and he found that in what was happening in hardcore. And then he just, through that, discovered the whole network of bands and just literally gave them all sessions, one after the other.
Punk. Ipswich is full of punks.
He's very tuned in to the subculture. It's amazing how tuned in, you know, he was to it.
It is a genuine counterculture. It exists entirely independently of everything, including the record industry and radio and so forth. I mean, they send me records, but only as an afterthought. And an interesting aspect of it, too, is that some of the bands that were featured on the programmes in session have come in for a certain amount of criticism for kind of compromising themselves, involving themselves with me and Radio 1. I quite like that kind of attitude.
I remember being on the door and thinking, well, here comes John Peel and his family. Should I let them in for free or charge them?
What did you decide to do?
I charged them.
Yeah. God knows what a lot of the people at the BBC must have thought of these Napalm Sessions and Heresy. I mean, it really must have ruffled some feathers at the time. I think Peely was just kind of, he'd done it for so many years that it was just like, well, he always plays this weird stuff. He caters that kind of art, we'll let him get on with it.
It's a funny place, Ipswich. It's got, what did they say? Negative ley lines or something.
Is that what they said?
Yeah. It has turned into one of those places that you know, when you get those coffee table books, shit places, people think of it as that kind of place. I would never have said that Ipswich was shit in the 80s. It was not a shit place. It's quite a prosperous place, and the music scene was fantastic.
The most of the hardcore bands, the punk bands, were so serious in their lyrics and their whole ethos, which was really, you know, attractive and was cool. But also, when you're that age, you don't really understand of
a lot of what they're talking about, you know. Whereas the Stupids came along and they had that energy and intensity, but they were really good fun.
I was Mr. American Hardcore. That was what I loved. A lot of people would say that American Hardcore was dead by 1982. For me, I was kind of got into it in 82. I think American Hardcore had all these different things all thrown into one, and it kind of seemed to be a unified thing. It wasn't obsessed with British politics. It wasn't obsessed, it wasn't crass, which was all you basically had before then. We didn't want to sort of sing about war and the bomb and how it's all going to end, and it was just being kids, really.
The mainstream did start to show quite a bit of interest in Heresy and these bands. And when we ended up with a situation with, you know, Sounds were writing about these bands and the music press were writing about them, Stupid's on the cover of The Enemy.
That's the one that I like. Def Jam in the front cover, Stupid's, Happy Mondays. When we were just as popular as the Happy Mondays, this is all really quite exciting stuff.
At that time, there was definitely the real crusty punk look that was still sort of hanging around from the crass era, with the, you know, big boots and shredded trousers. The old school, you know, Mohican punk look was still there. But then you had the kind of really American influenced stuff coming in as well, brought in by like the Heresy and the Stupids and stuff. People starting to wear baseball caps and hoodies.
The first thing I kind of started noticing was the kind of upturned cap thing. Everyone was doing this with their hats. And, you know, bright colours and sneakers, trainers. Up until that point, it was very ragged and very black, you know, army green or black. I started doing it because, you know, the American bands I liked were doing it, and that kind of went hand in hand with skateboarding. You'd see someone across the street wearing a pair of Chuck Taylor Converse. You would just go over there and go, where did you get them from? Because it was just so unusual. These little fashion things were sort of a mark of, they're almost like a sort of secret fraternity.
It's most fun when it's just you and your friends, isn't it? And it's your secret sort of society. But unfortunately, that never really lasts for long, and you just gotta just sort of, you know, roll with it.
It really felt like it went in very different directions in the 90s. And it kind of changed so quickly, because by sort of 1988, 89, a lot of these bands like Heresy and Ripcord had started to split up. New bands were starting to come in. Lots of different genres and scenes.
If anything, it got bigger in that way, because more American bands are coming over, and the American thing was really big. You know, Bad Religion, all of a sudden, the Suffer album. We played them in London, it was 200 people, and 40 were from Newport. But the next year they come out, it was 2,000 people. All of a sudden, that tune for Melodic Punk got really big, and then Green Day and Offspring, and that shit was on MTV. We played in Wigan with Green Day and Wat Tyler, I think it was. And then next night, Green Day were playing TJ's. And they, all the gig went off, it was great, and they had nowhere to stay. So they stayed in the house, and they were young kids, they were like 15, 16. So it was before anyone was big. Like, I said, I got to go to work in the morning, so not too much noise. So they had sleeping bags, and they said, got to go to sleep now or I'll kill you. So I went to bed, and they were fucking making all this noise. So I come down, and they all had their sleeping bags on. They were jumping up and down. So I grabbed the samurai sword off the wall and started swinging it around, you know, just above their heads. And they were ducking, and I was just like laughing. But I was drunk as well. And then it was about 3 years ago, their autobiography came out, saying the first time he ever came to Britain, they stayed with this guy in Wales and he tried to kill us with a sword and stuff like that. Yeah, they were just ordinary kids having a laugh. I didn't try to kill them, he was just fucking about. Like, but they, with being Americans, they got no sense of humour. And like us Welsh people, hey, what are you doing? Having a laugh. And this was a photo of all my mates from school. He's like, that's my mate Peter Pretty, got killed in a car crash. He's still quite active. He's a doorman in Bramall. That's mate Stephen Pearce, he drunk himself to death. Yeah, it's a good social document and shows that every little place
however big or small it was, we had our own little scene. It was ours. I mean, this was all us. This is in the Welsh Valleys. This is. Think fucking King's Road posing for fucking tourists, like.
This is TJ's. The windows have been painted over because you could actually see in there.
There's a little bit there by the looks of it.
For us and for a lot of people, not just in Newport, a lot of people travelled from all over the country and bands came over literally from all around the world. A lot of times the bands would stay upstairs in the flats. It was really down to earth, really small stage, everybody in your face. Very rarely was any trouble, no trouble at all. It was just like a friendly atmosphere. It's really sad, there were lots of good times in here, like, you know. And seeing it close is sad. Things change. So yeah, it's hard to explain what it means to you. It's part of you. It doesn't like saying, oh, I used to be into this type of music. It's like, it's just the way you are. I can't leave that behind whether I'm not in a band anymore. The social comment and the politics and the awareness and asking the questions about stuff. That's what stays with you. It changes you.
I like the term hardcore because to me it was at the end of Ripcord, I wasn't even doing any damping on the car. It was just pure chords, yeah, and just simple straight beats, minute songs. Yeah. That's
minute songs all over, no lead breaks, nothing like that. Sounds really boring, but that's what we liked.
The thing that defines it all is DIY, is doing it yourself. That's it. For all the different styles of music, all the different eras, whether it's, you know, putting on a gig, doing your own magazine, playing in a band, everything, it's the participation. It's that, to this day, is what defines it.
This kind of burning obsession, for me, that's what it's about. And being for real and not caring about, you know, popularity and all that kind of shit, that's hardcore.
That's what I do, what I'm involved in, and there's a passion, it's part of your life, you know? I think that stays with you. Never, whether you go to another club like that again, you still feel that type of way, like, you know? I like the Make Pig says, you see all these kids in the weekends now and fucking tattoos and piercings. It's all trendy. It's like, we fought the punk war for you kids. We used to get beaten up and people take the piss and we were ostracized and fucking people being aggressive towards us for looking the way we did. Now it's fucking, I'm trendy again. 49 and I'm cool. Hey! See my backpack?